I had Logan Paul on my podcast.
Would Logan do it with me?
Logan would kick your ass, I think. Mm. You're riding a fantastic wave. How could you not make some mistakes along the way?
How can you be for small government and then have the government dictate all these things in your personal life,
exactly.
Right? You idiots. You got it completely wrong.
Can't you just wake up and stop? Exactly. I was walking down the hallway like a dotted bull with a needle sticking out of my ass. Tell me the five steps to like, to the gates of the point where someone like you would say, I want this guy in my life. I want to help this guy. Hey, Jordan Belfort here, the Wolf of Wall Street, and welcome to the Wolf's Den podcast. Let's get down to it. I have an awesome, incredible guest today. Before I get there, as always, though, I am going to frame the idea of the day myself, and then I will call my guest on to dig more deeply into this topic. And the topic is, ready for this? How do you find your starship? Meaning what you were meant to do in this world. What is your true talent in life? What's your passion in life? What's your highest level function? Or put another way, what do you want to do when you grow up? I think that, you know, for me, I'm fortunate in the sense that I realized relatively early in my career what my strengths were, what my passion was, and then how to essentially monetize those things, turn it into a business, and live a life that to me, felt congruent. In other words, when I was very young, my mother had drilled into my head that I should be a doctor or a dentist because that was the only noble way to become wealthy. That was something that she'd said to me when I was in the high chair and she was spoon-feeding me applesauce. You have to be a doctor, a dentist. Like, it's like freaking hypnosis, right? And I actually did go as far as applying to medical school and dental school, and I got in. Spent one day in dental school. Why dentistry versus medicine? Well, medicine would have been another 8 to 10 years of studies after college. I would have put a bullet in my head at that point. I wanted to get rich tomorrow. So I figured dentistry was only 4 years. I'd still be Dr. Belfort, and that would be that, right? Well, thankfully, the dean of the school did me a big favor, and some of you might have heard this story before, where the dean said, you know, the golden age of dentistry is over. It's my first day in the school. So if you're here to make a lot of money, you're probably in the wrong place. And I was like, what the hell? And I dropped out, like, the first day, right? And I went on my path to become a salesperson and ultimately an entrepreneur and a business owner. But here's the thing. How many of you right now, as you listen to this podcast, are not really living your own dream, not really working at something you're truly passionate about, and that you're good at? How many of you are living someone else's dream? The ideas that were put in your head, in your body, your soul, like since you were, you know, 2 or 3 years old, like what you should be, what represented success, and you go down this path, and you put one foot in front of the other, and before you know it, you're acting and living a life that's really not the life that's your own. It's not your authentic self. And because of that, you never really feel like you're in flow. You're not particularly well suited to what you're doing. You don't feel that greatness, that burn, I call it. You're burning bright. And you're fully engaged in every moment of your life, and you feel like every second makes sense. You're moving forward. You see your vision clearly. You're moving towards that vision. How many of you are just literally in a spot right now that's almost a result of like what other people thought you should be doing or what society thought you should be doing? It's not your own life, or it's certainly not your best life. When we talk about finding your starship, that means it's almost the convergence of what you truly love and care about. What's your absolute passion from the bottom of your feet to the top of your head? What is it that you're passionate about? And at the same time, that needs to converge with what you're actually great at. See, if you're passionate about something, but you kind of suck at it, I mean, you don't have the natural ability, well, you know, you could eventually eke out an existence at it after a lot of really hard work, but you're never going to be one of the greats, one of the best. And maybe that's okay if you want to live an average life. Conversely, you might be great at something and have a real talent for it, but doing it makes you absolutely miserable. So yeah, you could go down that road as well, and you could sort of, you know, try to force yourself to do something you hate every single day and then rely on your natural ability to offset the lack of enthusiasm and the commensurate lack of hard work that will result. In other words, if you don't like doing something, eventually you will shy away from it. You will, you know, you're not going to be moving towards that. You won't be going at it full tilt. So you'll just do as much as you have to get by. So even though you have a massive talent for something, if you hate doing it, then it's probably not going to be that great career path you should go down. Let me give you a perfect example of my own life. I happen to be a great writer. I really am. I can write as good as pretty much anyone out there. And the reason for that is that I spent about 18 months when I was back in jail, and I taught myself to write. I spent about 10 to 20,000 hours teaching myself to write, and I was able to harness something that I had in me. It was a talent I had in me, but I was able to harness that through lots of hard work and modeling other great writers like Tom Wolfe, Hunter S. Thompson, right? And the result of that was the book, The Wolf of Wall Street. And that book then created this whole life for me that flowed from having a movie made, being a sales trainer, an entrepreneurship trainer, right? It all came from the beginning of writing this book, The Wolf of Wall Street. Now, in order to essentially go down that road to become this, you know, a famous person with a brand and a trainer of entrepreneurs and salespeople, I was always a trainer of salespeople, but to become famous for it globally required me to write this book. Now, believe it or not, after I wrote this book and it started getting massive traction, and I knew, listen, you know, listen, I'm not going to be cocky here, but the truth is I knew I was a great writer. I obviously got a lot of accolades from the New York Times, from my own publisher, and they were saying, oh my God, you're going to have this amazing career as a writer. And I actually deluded myself for a time into thinking I'd be like a Tom Clancy or a Tom Wolfe. I'd be a professional author. I actually thought that. There's only one problem. I despise writing. I absolutely, positively hate it. The thought of having to write a book is enough to make me want to go jump out a window. And ironically, I'm about to start writing another book right now. I have to write another book. Why am I doing that? Because it's important for my career overall, long term, what I do with training entrepreneurs and empowering salespeople. Helping people find their own path in life, right? Well, I need to be writing another book right now. I have a great topic to write about. But the point is that I'm not a writer. I'm not branding myself. I don't think of myself as a professional writer. That's my career. If that was what my lot in life was going to be, honestly, I'd have one of the most miserable lives you can imagine because I'm doing something every single day, day in and day out, year after year, that I absolutely despise doing. I hate it, but it happens I'm really good at it. So yeah, I can make a lot of money and be miserable my whole life and eke out this sort of miserable, wealthy existence. Is that what you want in your life? I don't think so. It's certainly not what I wanted in mine. And I pretty quickly found out, and I remember the exact day I was with my former, you know, partner and wife, right? And Ann and I were up, I think it was in Mendocino, California, and I was in the middle of writing the second book, the sequel, the follow-up book to The Wolf of Wall Street called Catching the Wolf. It was another book. I'd written actually both books, and I was writing now a third book called The Mortgage Man, and it was about the mortgage crisis that was about to happen. I predicted it, right? And I was writing this book about that, and Ann always loved this book, and she loved reading the early pages, and I was in Mendocino, and I remember being absolutely, positively miserable because all day long, I had to write. And I just hated the process of putting the words out on paper. I was very critical of myself. I didn't feel like it flowed organically. So I had learned a strategy for writing that was very effective. It turned out excellent work product, but it made me miserable while I was doing it. And yet, when I would go out and speak publicly, in the past, I hadn't started doing this yet before I became a speaker in my new life, right? In the past, when I was back at Stratton and other companies I had, when I was motivating salespeople, giving speeches, and I watched the people's faces, they were all clapping and cheering. I loved doing that, and it was effortless to me. So now watch this fork in the road that I was at. Okay, I could continue to keep writing And there were companies, publishers, willing to pay a lot of money for my books. And over time, I'm sure, as I wrote book after book after book, right, those royalties keep building and building and building. I still receive royalties today from the Wolf of Wall Street. And that's a great thing, right? And I could have kept on that path. But I would have been miserable. And I never would have really, I think, been able to essentially feel that I was on the right path for me in my own life, that I had a vision that I connected with that was important to me. It mattered. I knew why it mattered, and I was moving towards that. Instead, I'd be moving towards my own misery every single day. So that's an example of the non-convergence of what you're really, really great at, but what you absolutely despise, versus that you love doing something and you're really good at it. That's your starship. Finding out what you were meant to do in this world. What were you meant to be? What is your best path forward? And I urge you one thing with my next guest who I'm calling on, who's got a resume that's like a mile long. I'm going to read it to you in a few minutes from now, and you'll just get a sense of just how powerful this guy is in his industry and has been in his industry, and how he talks about his ability to find someone else's starship. It's in the field of music, right? And what happens when people are trying to become famous in the world of music, but don't really possess that convergence of talent and passion. They never really make it, or very, very, very seldom make it to the top. And if they do, they usually implode when they get there because they're freaking miserable. So what I'm saying to you here, in short, is that whatever you are right now in your life, it is never too late to take a good look at yourself, like to step outside your body, look down at your life and say, am I living my most authentic, greatest life right now? Am I doing what I was meant to be doing, what I love doing, what I'm great at doing? Am I in flow, or am I just here because of a series of events where I was kind of manipulated, prodded, cajoled, or forced by some realities at the time that put me on a path? And next thing you know, I was putting one foot in front of the other, and inertia got me to where I am right now, and I'm freaking miserable. Or barely scraping by. And I don't mean monetarily, I mean barely scraping by on the scale of happiness and fulfillment. I believe that money is crucial. I always say I've been a rich man, I've been a poor man, I choose rich every time and never look back. But if getting rich and staying rich means I'm going to be miserable every single day, that's not a recipe for living a great life. In order to find your star chip, as this person calls it, in a sense, what is that convergence of what I'm great at and what I love, what I'm passionate about? It starts with taking a step outside your body, looking down at your life the way it is right now, and just getting freaking honest. Seeing your life as it is in this moment, accurately, not worse than it is. Not like, oh, I'm too old, I'm too stupid, I'm too from the wrong family, I'm just on my... You know, people do this. When you look at your life, you'll say, whatever, I'm stuck, and you'll start creating this narrative, a story around why you can't change direction, why you can't actually get what you want in life. And one of my most famous quotes is, it's the story or the bullshit story that you tell yourself about why you can't get what you want in life that actually stops you from getting what you want in life. Because again, the first step in change, the first step in improvement, the first step in living that authentic life with your starship being aligned, meaning you're living that life that you should be living, it starts with getting honest. If you're not going to get honest with yourself, you have no basis for change. The best metaphor I've ever used for this is the way a car navigation system works, right? You have a car navigation system. Well, guess what? You're sitting in your car. What do? The first step is you plug in your destination, right? You want to plug in. That's where you want to go. So in other words, that would be, imagine saying, you know what? I want to go to XYZ location. That's your most authentic life. That's your starship. I want to be my best self. I want to make a lot of money, love doing it, feel alive every single day, feel passionate, feel connected. I want to give back. I want to feel spiritual. All the greatest things life have to offer, right? That's your destination. That's where you want to end up, right? And again, with a car navigation system, the way it works is, you know, essentially you plug in that destination and the software will take you there. It shows you turn right, turn left, slow down, go merge onto the highway, get off the highway. It tells you how to get from where you are to where you want to go. So the first step in redesigning your life is that, number one, you have to say, where do I want to go? What is my most authentic self? What am I great at? What am I passionate about? And then that's going to serve as your destination, right? Then once you have that destination, well, guess what? There's going to be certain work you got to do. There's going to be strategies that you need to learn, people that you need to know, groups that you need to associate with to help you achieve what you want. In other words, if you want to live your most authentic life, your greatest life, where you're passionate and rich and everything else, right? Well, guess what? Typically, there's going to be some work to do. What are the strategies I need to learn? Do I need to be an influencer? Probably so. How do I close the deal? How do I raise money? How do I hire the right people? How do I sell other people on getting involved with me so they can help me create my own vision for the future? How do I get others to buy into my vision? Every great CEO, every great business owner does that. They get other people excited to buy into their vision. How do you do that? These are all strategies that you'll need to know to get to that destination you want to go. And that represents in this metaphor would be like the actual software, the tech, the tactics and strategies that the onboard navigation system uses to get you to this destination. And these software programs are really good these days, right? You put in where you want to go, it'll get you there pretty much every single time. But there's one other thing that you have to know in order for the navigation system to work. And that is you must have an accurate starting point. And that's why every single chip, every single car has a chip that works as a GPS indicator. It tells the satellites exactly where the car is at any given moment in time. It serves as an accurate starting point. So the chip in your car, that always tells the system, hey, here's where we are right now. If you remove that chip from the equation, guess what? The navigation system breaks down and you will never get to the target you want to get to. So in order for you to think about this in terms of like, you know, how do you take action? Well, it starts with number one, where do I want to go? What is my best life? What was I meant to do? What's going to make me jump out of bed every single morning and run, not to work, because it's not really work anymore. It's just my life, to run, to create, to build, to achieve, to grow. What does that life look like? What do you do for a living? Who are you associated with? What industry is it in? What are you doing? That starts there. You always got to start with where I want to go. And why does that matter to me? And you want to make sure that that destination, that target, is the convergence of A, what you love. You better love. When you think of that destination, you better just get goosebumps. Like, oh my God, if I was living that life, I would just be so happy. I'd jump out of bed. You want to feel it in the back of your neck almost. Like, just like, if that was my life, it would just be unbelievably awesome. And then also, do I really have the God-given or nature-given talents to at least set me up for success? Or am I fighting this wildly uphill battle, trying to swim against the current where I just have no natural ability, no talent? It's probably not going to be the best way to go out and achieve your best life. You'll have frustration, you'll have constant setbacks, and you'll be passed by those that also have that same passion but also possess talent. And again, I'm not saying you can rule anything out because of natural talent, but I need to be honest with you. You want to try to pick something that you're actually good at, not that you suck at, and then try to get decent at it. That's a very, very tough way to try to get rich in this world and live a great life. You want to have something you actually are predisposed naturally to succeeding at, and then yet you're also passionate about, and that's going to be that authentic self, that authentic life. And then that next step is going to be, where am I right now? Looking at your life honestly, broadly, without prejudice, and saying, here's where I am. here's my starting point, here's what I know, here's what I don't know, and here's what I have to learn. Here are the strategies I need to learn, here are the people I need to know, the groups I need to align myself with. That's what that starting point serves as. And then you just study, learn, grow, and you take action as an entrepreneur, as a success-oriented, empowered individual. I promise you, there's a whole host of things that have to happen here, of course, right? With how do you take action the right way? How do you formulate your business plan? These are all the things that we teach as entrepreneurship. How do you essentially take your ideas and turn them into reality? But they always start by having that target. Where do I want to end up? Where am I right now? And what do I need to learn? And who do I need to know? And what groups do I need to align myself with in order to get there? That's how you live your best, most authentic life. Just remember this. I don't care where you are right now in life. I don't care whether you're at the bottom of love, of money, I mean economically, of just everything, even in the lowest point in your life of how you feel about yourself. How society feels about you. You know, we all go through ups and downs. It is never too late to begin the process of putting one foot in front of the other and moving towards your most authentic, greatest life. It is never too late. There's work to be done. There's skills you got to know. One of them for sure is persuasion. And that's why when I do trainings, I always focus on this necessity that you must learn how to close the deal. And when I say close the deal, it's not just close the deal and as a salesperson, but close the deal. Get people to see things your way. To get people to want to buy into your ideas, your hopes, your dreams, your thoughts in a way that makes them essentially move to take action and you get what you want as well. That's what ethical persuasion is all about. Bottom line. So with that now, I want to bring on a guest. And I don't really do this here, but I actually have a bio here. I want to read this to you, this guy, okay? His name is Charlie Walk. Some of you might know who he is. Charlie Walk is the self-proclaimed wolf of music. When you meet him, you'll see it's probably true, okay? But let me just give you a quick background of Charlie here. So he launched his career at Columbia Records, served as the president of Epic Records and then Republic Records. He's founded and been responsible for breaking the following groups and individuals. Ready? Aerosmith, Ariana Grande, Beyonce, Billy Joel, Bruce Springsteen, Demi Lovato, Destiny's Child, Drake, Enrique Iglesias, Florida Georgia Line, The Fugees, Haley Steinfeld, Jennifer Lopez, Joe Jonas, The Jonas Brothers, John Mayer, Lauryn Hill, Mariah Carey, New Kids on the Block, great story there. Nicki Minaj, Nipsey Hussle, Post Malone, Ricky Martin, Shakira, Shawn Mendes, and Taylor Swift, and then also Will Smith, Wyclef Jean. It goes on and on. It's ridiculous. He's a guy who's been honored by Billboard's Power 100, top of the heap in his industry. And when we come back to the Wolf's Den, you're going to meet Mr. Charlie Walk, who is absolutely awesome and a true force to recommend.
It may sound corny, but you gotta believe. Someone's gotta believe. Gut before data. You know, we're in such a data game right now. Everyone looks at the same data. Well, someone has to make a decision to put someone in a movie, or believe in a script, or believe in your book, or look at you with Wolf. Someone had to believe that your story would matter. Is there fucking data on that?
Right.
So I think the emotional part, the gut part, and having the confidence to make those decisions is something that I take with me every day. And I think I just had a lot of balls.
All right, so we are back now. And listen, as I promised, I do indeed have the wolf of music. I got Mr. and the world famous Charlie Walk, who is
great
awesome,
to see you,
by
Jordan.
The way. He's already become a good friend of mine, someone I love, respect, and has me laughing constantly. This is gonna be an awesome session. So let's start, okay. So listen, you're a legend, you're a character, you are the wolf of music, you're a wild man, but I want you to just get right into the thick of this. Just tell me how you got started very quickly and just do your thing. Just go be yourself.
Okay, so it's funny, when I think about me, I think about what I actually talk about when I look at you or very successful people, and it's that starship. It's identifying that starship that makes you the best that you can be, whether it's a Wall Street icon like yourself, a doctor, someone that's a tech guy, someone that's doing startups, someone that's a dentist, right? They're born with that certain chip. And if you identify it early enough, you get there faster. Your road to success becomes so much clearer, right? Because you actually are doing what your God-given chip has been developed in your DNA. So with me.
Your authentic self, basically.
100%.
Yeah.
7 or 8 years old, I found myself listening to a AM radio. And at the time, there was no internet and YouTube and cell phones. You had a radio. And the funnel for music was radio, and the funnel for visuals was TV. And I found myself, my parents caught me in the bedroom, not with girls or not reading books, but listening to music via the local radio station outside of Boston, Massachusetts. And I was listening and analyzing the new songs that would come on,
right,
and started my own sort of hit prediction list. And I found that I was more often right than not, maybe by 90%. Whether I could, at that time, think about maybe today it's called an algorithm, but there was something about Goosebumps, right? That gut before data, something that
sounded
made me,
good, made you want to listen
a
to
memorable it. Lyric, a repetitive, sticky lyric that just made me feel. And then I was like, well, as this is happening to me, well, maybe what I have, my gift, is I'm representing the people. And so over the course of like elementary school, kids are playing football and baseball. I am this tortured kid, not really understanding my gift, right? How do you explain to your father's a dentist, your mother's an amazing school teacher, and you're sitting there just, you know, everyone's doing everything else but like this unique kind of weird, lonely talent that I know I have, but I can't articulate it.
Right.
So that happened through elementary school and high school.
And did you get into like music as a musician?
Of course I did. You know, so I did. Like, what are you going to do? Yeah, you're right. Playing the drums, singing in bands, doing all this bullshit that I guess for me, I loved at the time, but I knew wasn't going to make me a dollar. So I'm sort of left brain, right brain. I'm artistic. I'm singing. I'm playing the drums. I'm like, how am I going to make any money doing this shit? So you know, as I'm into high school, and now I'm really getting tortured. What college are you going to? How are your grades? And I'm like, I know that my grades have nothing to do with my starship, right? Fair enough. I know this, but you have to do it. It's protocol, and parents want you to do well in school. You're kicked out of the house and your allowance, right, and all that stuff. So I did a couple of things. I started working at the local burger joint and the car wash just to make money to buy some music equipment, buy maybe a better boombox at the time, right? Whether it was cassettes. So this was like during the cassette era.
Sure.
If you don't know, Google cassette. And then I figured out, okay, now I'm in college. As I'm graduating high school, my mother said, if you really want to get ahead, you got to get an internship in something that you love.
Right.
And I remember that was the best advice she said, get an internship. She didn't know how I was going to get it. I had no family connections. There was no financial connectivity or the guy. My dad was a dentist. Right. If I wanted to be a dentist, I would have been in great shape living in Newton, Massachusetts. But I wanted to do what was coming to me since I was a little kid. Be in the music business, but actually help move culture.
Right.
I believed, not from an ego perspective, that that's what I was here to do.
Sure.
To be a very unique marketing, promotion, music guy that could consistently sort of reinvent the wheel and understand that every song is a startup, every new artist is a startup, and applying that mentality, even back in the day when startup wasn't a word, that's sort of how I was thinking when I look back of the analysis of what I needed to do. So I took on two internships that I fought for. Number one, I went to CBS Records and auditioned to get this big gig of a college rep making $50 a week.
Right.
I got that gig, and then I wanted to go to the local radio station. I went to the local radio station, the biggest station in America, and I fought and clawed my way through the receptionist, calling, until they said, fine, you can work with the program director who controlled, basically,
right,
the biggest songs in America out of his FM station that had like a 15 share. Now, do you know what a 15 share is? So in Boston, 15% of the market listened to his station. And if something broke there, it spread to LA, right, Philadelphia, Chicago, Dallas. It was that sort of interesting, very thin funnel that moved culture. And I think about the funnel. Like now it's, you know,
TikTok,
we have all the.
This one, Flash, Spotify, you know, right? You have SoundCloud.
SoundCloud today, yeah. YouTube tomorrow. You don't know what it's going to be. It morphs and moves because everyone has a very short attention span. But this forced you to really have one funnel. And if you figured out how to play in that funnel, you controlled it. Right. So I did both. I learned the record side and the radio promotion side at 17, 18, 19, 20.
So you realize, I think your first big shift and that really puts you on the road to finding your starship was saying, you know what? My path is not as the artist per se, the front guy. I'm the business guy. I'm the visionary. I'm the guy behind the artist. It's going to essentially make people famous and be the business side of music. Is that really what happened?
100%. I think I figured out, even being in the band, I was like, am I really going to be a lead singer with my long hair? Like, I'm 5'3". Like, we're not doing this. I'm not a rock star.
Well, I don't know about the hype. Because what's his name? I'm from AC/DC. Come on, right?
But he wore, you know, he wore those pumps. So
he's also fucking amazing.
He was an anomaly.
Prince?
Yeah, he also, well, these guys also wore those.
You know, they're freaking talented.
No, of course.
The point was, is your talent.
I wasn't that. My talent was something else.
Was in the other side.
And right? That goes to the starship. Who am I really? Am
That's
I a front man or am I the guy behind the artist? Am I the artist behind the artist? And
let me ask you one question before we go further. Do you think that you can fight your starship and succeed at a wildly huge level, or you're almost like bucking the trend, swimming against the current? You think it's possible? Just, you know, you got to identify your starship. Is that step one, identify your starship?
For anyone, whether it's music or any vertical that excites you, that you got to see it early, and I think your parents are involved in it. I think your parents can, if you go back and speak to all the moms of the artists I broke, it's the same exact conversation of the biggest stars in the world.
I had a guy on my podcast, brilliant guy, named Ed Milette. If you know Ed. Ed has his own podcast. You should listen to it. It's great. Ed was on my podcast, and I asked him a question about, you know, the similar thing. I said, you know, do you think people should follow their passion and try to monetize their passion or monetize what they're great at? He goes, monetize what they're great at. Fuck your passion. Like, in the sense that it will be great if your passion aligns with what you're great at and is monetizable. Right. What happens very often is that what you're great at might not be monetizable, by the way. It might just not be a thing that you could ever make a lot. And if you want to make a lot, you're going to have to go in another direction. Or you might just suck at what your passion is.
Right.
And if that's the case, you're going to get it real. And you could be a hobby, but it can't be what your life's mission is going to be. Right. Or else you're going to be facing a really tough uphill battle of becoming successful at the level that you really want to live that life that we both have lived. Now, getting back to that, you found your starship. You said, I'm not going to be famous as a singer or a rocker, but I'll be the guy that finds the talent and also promotes them. Well, finds a hidden talent, right?
Right. And I think when I got in the band, I wanted to feel what it would be like to be on stage with lights and smoke and packing your car up and
part
your
of
drums.
Your journey in a sense, right?
Yeah, so I could actually say to an artist, by the way, I was in a band and I sang, I sucked, but you know, I you know, not even from a self-deprecating point of view, but from a point of view that I tried to do. I understand. It's like making sausages at the beginning. No one cares until they care. The journey of an artist, of these kids, it's the most lonely thing in the world, because you know, actually, you're probably a star. You know, you've identified your starship. If you look at Justin Timberlake or Britney Spears or Christina or even Beyonce, if you look at all the biggest stars over the last many years, if you ask their moms at 7 or 8 years old, they were auditioning, they were in training, they were Olympians in the sport of music at a very early age. Shawn Mendes, who I helped break and adore and love, he broke off an old platform called Vine. He is a gold medal Olympian the way he trained to get to this place.
Got
he
it.
Didn't wake up at 15 and say, I want to sing and play guitar and be the biggest star in the world. If you would ask his mom, they'll have that same thing. Now they know it, and that's the lonely period where hopefully I can get in, or I have gotten in early enough and identify it.
Give me an example of someone that you broke. Great. Give me a good story here.
There's a lot of stories, as you know.
That you think is a funny one, but a really poignant one that illustrates this point.
Well, I think New Kids on the Block was a critical point in pop culture, if anyone remembers New Kids. They were the follow-up to a boy band called the Beatles. So when you think about boy bands, you think about NSYNC, Backstreet Boys, maybe One Direction. The Beatles were a boy band.
I never really looked at him like that, but it's true when you think about it. Right?
Someone said that to me 5 years ago, and I'm like, I'm an idiot. I should have thought of that first.
It's true.
It's true. The follow-up to...
Like in the Shea scene, the girl's like fainting and going, right?
Same thing. Shut your eyes, look at the tape. Same thing. So music was different, of course. You know, the songs are better, right? Beatles. But still, you know, you think about stadiums and arenas. You know, as long as there's little girls, there's going to be boys, right? Rock stars. So I started to work with New Kids, and I was thinking about the Beatles a lot. There hadn't been a group to break in the United States since the Beatles. Now, I got lucky because I was from Boston, working in Boston, and they introduced me to a band that was putting together a couple years ago called NKOTB, New Kids.
Who are the New Kids? Like, who are the individual, anyone that I would know now?
Well, Donnie Wahlberg, you would certainly know, whose brother's Mark. Mm-hmm. And he's sort of the leader of the game. Joey McIntyre, Jordan Knight, Danny Wood, and Jonathan Knight made up New Kids on the Block. They're doing numbers like you've never seen from a nostalgia point of view.
Right.
I ran into Donnie Wahlberg last week in New York. He's playing Fenway Park in the fall. I mean, it's you know, they have fans that never forgot. That's true artist development, right?
Sure.
True legacy. But we had a challenge.
How did you develop? How'd you break that
so,
band?
So it was me and others, right? It takes a team. It takes an army. But I was a part of figuring out what I guess we would call an algorithm, a local algorithm of glocal. And what glocal is, global vision, local activation. Something has to break first in a local market. If you really think about how anything starts, right?
Same thing. Every international, multinational company started by selling one product to one person and then realized they get some traction and one foot in front of the other, and before you know it, bam.
So when you're in the huddle and you're listening to the music and you're seeing these kids and you know you're with greatness, right? Starship, put together magic, amazing songs. The right stuff. You're just like, this is magic. No one gives a shit. No one cares. The mothers care. I used to take my little beat-up car to Donnie's house, and Mark Wahlberg would be one of those playing the drums, and I met the mom and picking them up to do promo. And, you know, it was like this. Every time it's that lonely sort of period in which you know you're in the back, you're in the car with these kids in the backseat, they're going to be the biggest stars in the world, but I'm the only one that knows. And that feeling is crazy and intense, and also brings upon a big insecurity because so much is riding on you at the beginning, right? But what we did was we said, well, where do kids go? They go to clubs. So what if we were to fill up the clubs that the young kids couldn't get into? And the mothers were too old to go to, but everyone knew about it. So we targeted like 9 Lansdowne Street, which is the hottest clubs in Boston. And we did these showcases at 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock on Sunday nights, Coca-Cola, Sprite, chips, cookies, and started building out this word-of-mouth buzz. Now, again, reminder, no internet, no YouTube, no cell phones, pure organic word-of-mouth. Our funnel was this. Our goal was radio. Right? What's the funnel? Word of mouth into excitement, maybe some local single sales, cassingles, I think they were called. You know, you're buying the cassette, then you get the store report,
right?
And then the radio station calls the local record store, the local tower. I mean, crazy town if you think about it. And it started to happen. That single started to develop, the right stuff. It started to build. And then the radio station that I worked at played it. And then the station in Connecticut played it. The station in Cape Cod played it, in New Hampshire, in Maine. And now you're breaking, right? So we talked about glocal.
Right.
It's Boston. Now it's New England.
Right.
Now it's East Coast. Philly, mm-hmm. With me, ATL. And then it spreads like wildfire.
Right.
And all hell breaks loose. And that was the beginning of one of the greatest journeys of a band that became, that allowed for NSYNC, which was Justin Timberlake, Backstreet Boys, of course, which are still on tour, making multiple millions of dollars a year.
Sure.
Vegas residency. And, of course, One Direction and all the Simon Cowell stuff that gives you Harry Styles and some mm-hmm. of the biggest pop stars of today.
What do you think your biggest lesson and takeaway is from that experience, you personally? What'd you learn from that?
It may sound corny, but you got to believe. Someone's got to believe. Someone's got to believe at the beginning. Gut before data. You know, we're in such a data game right now. Everyone looks at the same data. If you think about all the music companies or even the entertainment companies looking at the data, algorithms and data to make decisions. Well, someone has to make a decision to put someone in a movie or believe in a script or believe in your book or look at you with Wolf. Someone had to believe that your story would matter. Was there fucking data on that? There was no data on that. It was a story that gave you emotion.
Right.
So I think the emotional part, the gut part, and having the confidence to make those decisions is something that I take with me every day. And I think I just had a lot of balls.
It's interesting that you say that, because in my case, it was a woman named Alexandra Milchan, Arnon Milchan's daughter. She was the person that I was on page 22 of my book. She read the first 10 pages, she says, I have to meet this guy. The book was being written. Don't forget a script, the book, right? I met her for lunch. She looked at me and goes, you're going to be the most famous person in the world. Leo DiCaprio's going to play you. This was like 2005. I was like, okay. And she's like, Leo's going to play you. Marty's going to direct this movie. Mark my words. And she believes so much that when you have someone in the industry, an expert behind you like that, you're right. Well, almost, you know, of course you have the artist, like I'm working my ass off doing my job, right? But you have to have someone, that business side in that industry that just, they care. It's not just right. Believe, they care so much, right? I think you cared. When you got hooked, so it almost became like a view, like a matter of pride in some respect, and just knowing that you're right, that you this person's a star, deserves to be heard. People are going to love this, and I know I'm right. I have to get right. It's a mission, right?
Right. Every time, you know, someone's got to care. Someone has to feel. Someone has to believe. And so many of my stories of success, I was kind of this odd, weird, lonely guy in the room trying to figure it out.
Let me flip it. So how many times did you find yourself in a position, work with someone that was already famous, but having trouble either getting to the next level or in a period of stagnation, and you had to look them in the eye and say, you know what? I'm sorry, but there's nothing special right now, and here's what you need to do, and like give them tough love or advice, and they just wanted to kill you for it. Do you find yourself as the business guy having to give people brutal honesty and tough love, and how important is that in the equation of managing and really helping people grow their careers?
Well, in a subjective business like music, like who the hell am I to say to you artists that made those records that it's not good enough?
Do you ever do that?
It's happened more often than not in my life. It's probably on my resume forever. Yeah.
Give me one example.
I have too many, so you're
going
to have
one. Give me one great. Give me a really funny, poignant example that we would all maybe know of a situation where you were so sure you were right. Everyone thought you were crazy. The artist wanted to kill you, but you did it and it worked.
I'm going to give you two.
Okay, give me two.
So the first one was on my first day at the job at Epic Records. I was a 31-year-old president. And this very big job, and I'm not even sure I was ready for it, but I took the job on and walked in. And the first meeting was with an amazing artist, one of my favorite artists of all time. So I was a fan also. I wasn't just a record guy. Her name was Shakira. And
Shakira.
And it's funny because I just saw her do this particular song amazing. In the Super Bowl, and I'm with amazing. My kids and wife, and I'm just you can't even believe.
I like the tongue thing she did.
Amazing. she's incredible.
Look better on her than me.
She's incredible. So she came in and her album had just released, so I had nothing to do with this album called Oral Fixation 2, follow-up to an amazing, successful global record that touched the world and actually helped shifted culture. So a lot was riding on this body of work, right? The follow-up to a massive, global, successful album. And she came in and she said, nice to meet you. And I said, nice to meet you, Shakira. And I'm like inside, I'm like, oh my God, it's Shakira. And I'm never really like that, but I was in awe of her art because she is that good.
She's so beautiful.
She's incredible in every way.
Right.
And sophisticated and smart and looks you in the eye. And she looked me in the eye and she said, my album is out. What do you think the next single should be? And I did my homework and I listened and my Walkman. I don't even know what cassette. I don't even know what the hell we had. Or CDs. Actually, CDs. And I had my little CD player. And I listened for the week prior to this meeting. And I said to her, I don't think you have another single. And she goes, what do you mean?
Oh,
I said,
God.
Well, I said, the first single
is short-lived career as an executive at Epic, right?
She goes, what do you mean? I said, well, the first single's out. It's called Don't Bother, and no one bothered.
To listen.
And she said, I need to understand. I'm looking for the next single, the next hit, for you to put out from this album that I spent 2 years making. I said, Shakira, I think it's a great body of work. You play the guitar. It's artsy. It's incredible. But you're asking me what the hit is. You're asking me what the pop hit is. And I'm thinking in my head, Caribbean, up-tempo, dance, on-brand. And she, in my opinion, went off-brand. Now, my job's to tell the truth because I have to make my numbers as well, right?
Right?
So we're both in this together. It's not really executive versus artist. Like, I have to help. I have a responsibility, right, to tell the truth. Unlike a lot of people in the music business that don't tell the truth, I actually told the truth. I was brought up that way. And she said, you're telling me there's not another single. And I said, I don't think there's a song that could go to radio on this body of work. So she left, stormed out. I got the call from, at the time, one of the presidents or chairmen of the company. Don't do your shit walk. Who do you think you are? You can't tell that to the artist. And I said, well, I was just being honest, because what am I going to pick a song that's not going to work and then we're stuck? We're going into Christmas. We've got to figure this out. And I was really, really, really upset. So, you know, when your back's against the wall, you have to make, right? You have to pivot. Jimmy Iovine, who's one of my mentors, taught me you have to pivot. Now, this was way later, but when I think back of Jimmy's words, I pivoted.
Yeah.
So I called Wyclef. Now, back in the early days of my career, 2021 or 22, I helped guide a group called the Fugees, which really moved culture. Wyclef Jean, Lauryn Hill, and Praz. And I remember being in the back of the plane with them. No one gave a shit. I mean, it was brutal breaking them. We broke them in the college circuit. No one understood this music. Fuji, La. It was very unique and different. Caribbean, Latin, Haitian, urban, just sort of hybrid mixed into this incredible new sound. I called Clef. I said, can I come see you? I have a problem. I have a situation. I said, I need a Caribbean up-tempo Latin smash for one of my artists. He said, come see me. And I go see him, and I said, I need something for Shakira. Do you have anything? He said, Charlie, I don't have anything. The only thing I have is a song from Havana Nights 2, Dirty Dancing, that's been on iTunes for 3 years that never became a single. Clive Davis made a decision to never put the song out as a single, but it's up on iTunes. I don't know what to tell you. I go, play me the song. He plays me the song. And the song was Wyclef featuring Claudette from City High. The song was called Dance Like This.
Okay.
And I heard the song. And I mean, I don't have a lot of hair on my arms, but hair grew. I'm known to stand on the tables and dance and be emotional, and I am emotional, and sometimes, you know, I'm too emotional. And I said, take Claudette off the verses right now. And he said, okay. And then Praz and I were like, well, maybe you could say Shakira, Shakira at the beginning of the record. And Clef went in that mic and said, Shakira, Shakira, and gave us a track of the same song, except Claudette was removed and we left the verses open.
And he said, Shakira, Shakira. I know what song it is.
So then we take the record, we send it to Shakira. And at the time, she wasn't collaborating with anyone. She didn't want to really work with Wyclef. And every artist has that option to make a decision whether they want to or not. And all I said was, this will change your life. This will change culture. Because at the time, she was what I call a tri-coastal artist. She could play in New York, Miami, and L.A. because of her Latin roots, but you can never play the middle. This song would allow her to play the middle. This song would allow Latin music and her to grow globally.
Crossover, in fact,
we did this.
If it worked.
I said, the responsibility here isn't just for you doing this record. It's for the Latin people. And that's just how I felt. And I said, I will deliver this record. Fast forward, she did the record. She wrote to it. She made it a better record, clearly. And
why don't we do this? I think it's worth it. Let's get the first song. You have that up on the, let's get the soundtrack playing here.
So,
all right, stop that now. All right, so that's the.
So we hear this record.
We all know this, obviously.
We hear this song, and I just say, could you take Claudette off that record, please, right now? The wonderful artist you heard in the verses. And fast forward, we transformed it into the studio that night into.
Let's hear it.
What has become one of the biggest Latin songs of all time, Hips Don't Lie. Anyway,
wow,
so. All
right. Wow. So just so you know, I fucking love loved and still love to this day. I love that song always.
Well, let me tell you a story. So I'm up all night with Clef and Praz, and Praz is with us as well, two of the remaining Fuji members. We get the record, and I, for some reason, I didn't call my wife, and, you know, I'm in the suit, and I came home at 7 with Schwitz all over my face and, like, dirt from the studio, and I said, I think we just did something really special that's going to change a lot of people's lives. He's like, well, you didn't call me. I said, I'm sorry, but I'm a music man, and sometimes we get caught in the studio. So I went in that day, showered, and I had my whole staff in the conference room. Comedians, right? Don't do committees. They're comedians. And I get the big speakers and I press play. And we play that song, Shakira, Shakira. And I'm grooving. My eyes are shut and feeling this record. And
it's amazing.
Doing my thing. And the song ends. And I go like this. And I'm the only one clapping. I'm the president. Clap. No one's clapping. So I go around the room and I look at, I remember my Tommy, Jacqueline, all the people around me, amazing executives. And no one will look me in the eye. And when they don't look the president in the eye, you know what that means?
They think it sucks.
They think it's shit. And they don't believe. And I'm going to have a real problem now because my troops aren't going to support me.
They have to pass that certainty out there.
And I'm a big eye contact guy. And just, you know, you don't have to say a word. And I know. Yeah. I understand it. So I said, okay, I'm going to go do it myself. I left that day at 12 noon, booked a flight to Los Angeles, California, and I went to see Julie Pilot, who's now at Apple Music. She was running Kiss FM in LA as music director. And I don't know how I ended up in a van. I rented a van. I don't even know how I'm in a van with her, and I played her the song. And she heard it, and she looked me in the eye and says, this will be one of the biggest songs in history. Put it on Kiss
so
FM.
So obvious to
she
me.
Put it on Kiss FM that night. Now, don't forget, LA is 80% Hispanic, which was great for me to start it here as opposed to Boston.
Right.
And this song just had number one phones at the time. What does number one phones mean back then? Sort of like text request. There's people actually call the radio station to request a song. They had phone ops.
Remember that days? And I love these days. As much as they were frustrating, they sucked, is that when you loved a song, you had to wait until it come back on the radio again. And sometimes you didn't even know the title of it. You'd call it like, what was the name of that song? Remember those days?
I did it when I was 8 years old. I remember the pop station was 68 RKO in Boston, 617-931-1668. I know the numbers. That's how messed up my head is. And really, that's how deep I went into like the process of understanding the anatomy of a hit, the anatomy of the audience, and where they sort of cross-pollinated to make something move culture back then without all the crazy stuff we talk about today.
What I remember is like 1-800-DOLLAR-ORGASM, but a little different, maybe.
It's true. And the other thing we're talking about, I know you asked me about, you know, stories that move culture. You know, I helped break John Mayer at the beginning. Now, John Mayer's one of the greatest guitar players that ever lived. He's on the level of Clapton, could even be better. Some people, you know, have their own opinions.
Really?
I think John's one of the... He was when I met him.
He's a beautiful singer. I didn't know he was...
No, John Mayer's one of the greatest guitar players of all time, period.
Really?
To me, he's the greatest guitar player of all time.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he is. And when I met him for Room for Squares, his first album, which was, you know, Your Body is a Wonderland, No Such Thing, Why Georgia Why, incredible records, I was obsessed because I was going to be a part of a journey to break, I think, one of the most important singer-songwriters at that time in my head. I believed if we did our work, he would be, right? And he became that. First album, after we did the right promo and marketing and John just did John, you know, became a massive success, many awards, accolations, global superstar. With the pressure of that after your first album, there's something called the sophomore release.
Right.
And most people fail because of the psychological pressure. Now, when you write your first record, you're free, spirited, you have money problems, family, you know, Billy, it's like Billy Joel when he told me he wrote Piano Man, like he had a lot of issues. He was the Piano Man. He stopped writing the Piano Man because he had jets and planes, and you're not writing about being the Piano Man in the bar anymore. So things change with money.
It's interesting,
that's, yeah. So that's why, like, the difference between the first album and second album, if you don't have your head on straight.
I got it. I'm sorry. I just have to tell you the story because you're going to love this.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was in the music business. I didn't even tell you that. My partners.
So you're the real wolf of music.
No, listen to me. You know who my partners were? Steven Swid.
Oh, my God.
And Artie Mogul. You know Artie Mogul?
Yeah, icons.
Artie Mogul was a wild man. Artie Mogul, he was like this old guy, like 80 years old. And he said, well, you know, I can't take my wife because, you know, she was like young. And she's like, you know, her idea of a great night or a great weekend is take a camper, go out into the high desert and you know, and go into the stars and commune with nature. Because my idea of a perfect weekend is to be locked in a hotel with a bag of blow and dope and five black hookers. This was Artie. He was like 81 at the time, Artie Mogul.
Oh my God.
Now, Artie Mogul was the president of a company that I owned in partnership 50-50 with Stephen Swit right after he sold SBK to Thorne EMIs. It was Mogul, it was Bandier, Kottman, and Swit.
That's right.
Right? So Swit and I were partners, and Artie was the guy buying the axe, right? And it went on for like about a year or two, whatever. I was an investor, but I was a big investor, sure. Right? And that was that. And after it didn't make money after a few years, we just wound it down. That was that. About, this is probably 96, 95, 96. I'm on my yacht in Oyster Bay Cove. I have a 170-foot yacht. And one of my business partners is there, and we're on my yacht, and a song starts playing on the radio in the yacht. And it's the song Hold Your Hand by Hootie and the Blowfish. And the song that comes out, and it's on the radio, and I'm like, hold your hand. And I'm just singing this on. And, you know, and when the song ends, the guy's looking at me. His name was Harry. He goes, wow, doesn't that really bother you? I'm like, what? He goes, well, you know, that you owned that act and that you blew it. I'm like, what are you talking about? He goes, you don't know? I'm like, no, what? He goes, my son Stanley, was Harry Schuster, and the son was Stanley Schuster. He worked for your company in A&R, and he was in Atlanta, and he heard this college band named Hootie and the whatever, and he fell in love with them. He took the band, flew them to California, put him up in his house, cut this album, right? We signed them under my label, which was JRS Records, okay? Puts this album right there. It's about to go out, and I think there was one final payment due of like $5,000 or $10,000. And Stephen Swid's mistress, not even his wife, his fucking mistress, hears the song. She goes, "It sucks. You'll never sell an album." He's like, "All right, fuck it." And he goes, "The right to check." And Atlantic Records picks up the act, and they go on to become Hootie and the Blowfish. Right? Thank God. Thank God their second album sucked moose cock, because if it didn't, it would have cost me like $250 million. So I got lucky. Wow. He goes, well, you know, it's not that big. The second album wasn't, as you said, that was when we think of it, because the first album was a huge success, but their follow-up was a disaster, and they faded away and never made anything.
Right.
That's interesting about how one person could just kill it like that, huh?
Well, there's so many different variables that happen to sort of the creative side of things and then the marketing side of things. And also the attention span, right? We're in an attention economy, especially right now.
Yeah.
To have an artist last for a very long time, they really have to be special, and they really have to reinvent themselves.
Do you think, so you brought up a point, I never thought of this before. I always said, like, I see it in business a lot. I see it especially in music and book writing, you know, artistry, where people have these, like, creative periods, windows of creativity, windows of brilliance. Like Albert Einstein had it with science, where in 1 year, in 1907 or 5, he has three papers he writes that changes the way we understand the universe. Mm-hmm. Theory of relativity, general relativity. I mean, it was unbelievable what he did. And then the rest of his life, even though he did amazing things, he never quite was able to recapture this window of brilliance. You see the same thing with all these artists, one-hit wonders. Mm-hmm. You just reduced it. I never really thought of it like, why is that? I guess I always chalked it to, like, you know, our brain has these like windows of where you get really creative. You tap into the all that there is and your own unconscious and the collective unconscious. And then it sort of fades away. And the idea is that when that window of opportunity opens up, you better fucking jump through and work your ass off, because you never know when it's going to close. Mm-hmm. But you just brought up an interesting perspective on it. You're like, in your idea, probably part of it is that what made a person great in the beginning, like the variables and the intensity and the anguish and the love and the hate and the wanting,
that had the universally relatable emotion
that set
which allows
up
you to connect. Why
when they became famous, they lost their authentic self in some way, and is that, you think, what causes people to not recapture that greatness they had? Does it take a fall? Does it take another? You know, what do you think that's about?
I think, you know what I'm saying, right? I think ego is the number one killer in the music business. Number one, number two, I went on a TV show, so my life was, I'm working for a massive label. We're killing it. Number one market share, breaking artist after artist. The Weeknd, Post Malone, Ariana Grande, and then I decided to do a TV show. So how does my life change? I'm in New York taking the subway to work every day.
Right.
So now I'm in LA, the Beverly Hills Hotel. I'm getting my eyelashes dyed. I have two rooms, one with my designer clothes stylist, two security. I can't make this up. Security guys, hair and makeup. I wake up in the morning doing my hair and makeup. They're putting this whitener stuff so my eyes aren't red. Then I'm going to set for 14. I mean, it's, and then you get caught up in that. I think I lost my mind for those 6 to 8 months of who I was, my purity. Do you understand?
Sure.
My passion. And I don't even think I really broke anything or did anything important in the music business because I was so caught up in my own sort of world, right? And think about an artist. So they become successful. Now they're on tour. Private jets. Everyone's around you. Yes, 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 yes. No one wants to get fired, so managers aren't really going to sometimes have that honest conversation.
Yeah.
You got to think about all the variables. Sometimes can mess up the longevity of anyone across any vertical.
So anyone, listen, share this with your friends. You got to get people listening to this podcast, this particular episode especially. The Wolf of Music, the Wolf of Wall Street. Talk again soon. God bless.